Time is tight, so I'll move straight on. The next item of business is a debate on motion 2804 in the name of Andy Whiteman on local democracy. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now, and I call on Andy Whiteman to speak to and move the motion. 8 minutes, please, Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy published its final report in August 2014, a little over 2 years ago. But yet, as far as I can tell, there's been no debate in Parliament on its findings. We've introduced this debate on local democracy for two reasons. First, we believe it's important to endorse the valuable work undertaken by the Commission and believe that its principles and findings should form the core of local democratic reform during this Parliament. Second, we want to make it clear that there's a difference, a very big difference, between community empowerment, which is voluntary and partial, and local governance, which is statutory and universal. I should also stress right at the beginning that by endorsing the report, I do not mean it to be implied that either the Scottish Green Party or any other party here necessarily supports every detailed finding contained within it. But it's worth reminding members that this commission is a cross-party endeavour. The Commission includes representatives of the Conservatives, Liberal Democrats, Labour, SNP and ourselves. And just as I don't expect that they would have agreed with every detailed particular of each and every paragraph, I don't expect members here to do so either. But by endorsing this report, we validate the effort that went into its creation. We support the efforts of our party colleagues who sat on the Commission. And we send out an important message that Scotland's national legislature, which spends considerable time considering its own competencies, structures and future, also has regard to the vital role that local governance plays in the democratic architecture of Scotland. Having said that by way of introduction, I want to congratulate the members of the Commission who, under the auspices of COSLA, produced this comprehensive and timely report. In particular, I pay tribute to Councillor David O'Neill, President of COSLA and Chair of the Commission, for his leadership. I'm aware that the Local Government and Regeneration Committee in the last session of Parliament published its report on flexibility and autonomy in local government in June 2014. The committee, convened by the now current Minister for Local Government, took a rather dim view of the arguments around strengthening local democracy. I went so far as to suggest that interest in it was limited to, and I quote, the narrow confines of academia and COSLA. This rather dismissive assertion is reflected in the SNP amendment, which claims that the committee took into consideration the work of the Commission. Quite how this would have been possible, given that the committee reported in June 2014 and the Commission published its final report 2 months later in August 2014, I shall leave for the Minister to explain. Turning to the substance of the matter, it's becoming increasingly clear that local government in Scotland is neither local nor does it govern. As the McIntosh Commission noted in 1999, it could be said that Scotland today simply does not have a system of local government in the sense in which many other countries still do. The 32 councils that exist are in effect what in other countries are called county councils or provinces. And as COSLA itself observed in 2013, Scotland's one of the most centralised countries in Europe. It's no coincidence that our European neighbours are often more successful at improving outcomes and have much greater turnout at elections. We cannot hope to emulate the success of these countries without acknowledging that they have more local councils, more local elected councillors representing fewer people, and that these councils and their services are constitutionally protected and their funding secured by law, even with regard to national policy making. In Scotland, we have 32 local authorities, yet the Netherlands has 408, Norway has 428, Belgium 589, while in Germany there are over 11,000 councils at this lowest tier of governance. And whilst there's been some amalgamation undertaken in these countries, there's been nothing like the stripping away, the hollowing out and the elimination of local governance that's taken place in Scotland. At the beginning of the 20th century, for example, Scotland started out with over 1,100 councils at the lowest tier. A century later, we've got 32. And so if we're serious about strengthening local democracy, as I believe we should be, then we need to be serious about doing something about it. Empowering communities is well and good, and we support it, but without a strong democratic structure, it risks providing opportunities for those already motivated and engaged, and provides very little for those communities that are marginalised and lacking in capacity. A community that needs action on local matters should not have to rely on voluntary effort that in turn requires it to be constituted into some form of corporate entity to make a statutory participation request to a local authority. The powers that are required should be readily available through the democratic structures within communities. Empowering communities and strengthening and deepening democratic institutions are complementary as too are other important approaches, such as introducing more participatory budgeting and greater community engagement. The Edinburgh University academic Paddy Bort noted recently, "Scottish local democracy has been compared to a ladder with the lower rungs missing. It is excluding Scots from running their own local affairs, denying them access to democracy. What we have instead is the reduction of citizens to customers, a marketisation of local governance, exacerbated by outsourcing and privatisation of services. No wonder that turnout at local elections is catastrophically low. Scottish voters clearly experience local government as something they're being excluded from and ignored by." The Commission's recommendations go a long way to providing a means of reversing these trends and providing those lower rungs. I understand that the Commission is soon to be reconvened. I'm very pleased about this and I wish it well. I hope that all parties represented in this Parliament once again participate. I also welcome the launch last week of Our Democracy, Act As If We Own the Place, a coalition of organisations, campaigners and politicians who are dedicated to improving our local democracy. So, Presiding Officer, during this fifth session of the Scottish Parliament, it's vital that we deepen and strengthen local democracy. Local councils are a vital part of how we are governed, and meaningful local control has been undermined and sidelined for far too long. Last week, the Minister responded to a question by stating that there were no town halls in Scotland. He's wrong. There are almost 200 town halls across Scotland. The only difference is they no longer have any democratic institutions inside them. As I said at the outset, by supporting this motion, you're not endorsing every detail of the Commission's report, but you are endorsing a clear direction of travel, which is to move Scotland toward being a more normal European country, where local communities enjoy hardwired, universal, local, statutory governance with fiscal responsibility exercised at the community level. Given that the two amendments to my motion delete the substance in its entirety, Green MSPs will not be supporting them. Presiding Officer, I know that there are many members in all parties who support the broad conclusions of the Commission. That should come as no surprise, given that it was an all-party endeavour. I hope that those who may not support our motion tonight because of how they're being asked to vote will, nevertheless, work with all of us who want to see a genuine restoration and strengthening of local democracy across Scotland. I commend my motion to members and move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whiteman. I call on Kevin Stewart to speak to and move Amendment 2804.2. Minister, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd first of all like to congratulate the Green Party for securing this debate on local democracy. There's much the Scottish Government shares with the Greens in terms of our vision for a healthy democracy. Like them, we believe that decisions that affect people's lives should be taken as near to communities as makes sense for those communities. That is why we both believe in an independent Scotland, a country where the people of Scotland are trusted to shape and take all of the decisions that affect our country's future. We believe that democracy should start in communities. Local people hold the sovereign power, and the job of democratic institutions is to help people achieve their goals. There will, of course, be points of detail that we'll no doubt debate today. But on many of the fundamental principles of how a modern democracy should work, there is much shared ground across this chamber. The government has always believed in the fundamental importance of local government in delivering better outcomes for all of Scotland's people. They can do this because councils and their elected members know their areas, their needs, and of course, their aspirations. Our relationship with local government is one of shared interests and mutual respect. Partnership with local government is critical in tackling poverty and inequality across Scotland. An excellent recent example of that partnership working is the Refugee Resettlement Scheme, which has been a model of joint working between central government, local authorities, partner organisations and local communities to provide a safe and welcoming home for people fleeing the continued violence in Syria. And I was pleased to meet folks in Moray just recently in Forest, Syrian families who have moved there, who expressed their gratitude for the joined-up approach to delivering services for them and their families. Another example of that joined-up approach is in housing. To deliver the housing targets we have set for this Parliament, we need to work together with local government and expand on what we do well. This will continue our collaboration over the last Parliament, which delivered over 30,000 affordable homes. We welcome the widespread debate that has taken place over the last few years on the future of local democracy. The in-depth look at democracy that has been carried out by the COSLA Commission and the Jimmy Reid Foundation have helped to lay some of the foundations for today's discussion, as did the work of the Local Government and Regeneration Committee that I was privileged to chair in the last Parliament. In our work, I was determined to hear directly from local people to shape our final report. I'm pleased that now, as Minister for Local Government, I'm able to take action shaped by many of the principles and recommendations set out in these influential reports. We believe that now is the time for real change in how local democracy works. And I can confirm today that we will build on the work we have already done on community empowerment and introduce a local democracy bill during this Parliament that will deliver real power to our communities. At this stage, I want to be clear about a few principles. The future of local democracy is not just about lines on a map or changing administrative boundaries and all the costs that are associated with that. Neither is it simply about ratios of electors to the elected. It's also not about absolutely everything being delivered at local level. What it is about is reinvigorating local democracy, strengthening community voices, and making the most of the talents of all of our communities in making people's lives better. Everybody living and working in Scotland, regardless of their background, can help to grow the economy and tackle inequality. A renewed local democracy is about people seeing real connection with their council and increased numbers of people from all parts of our diverse society voting. And we have a track record of making changes like this happen in Scotland. This Parliament passed the Community Empowerment Act last year, giving communities new rights to expand community ownership and have their voices heard. The Islands Bill will reflect the unique needs of our islands communities. This local focus is complemented at regional level. This government recognises that cities and their regions are the engines of our economy. Some two-thirds of Scotland's GVA is generated within our city regions. We have two city deals in delivery in Glasgow and Aberdeen, with Inverness agreed in principle, and now have all our other cities at various stages in discussing deals. We have committed £760 million over the next 10 to 20 years to the first three deals. So there is much to build on and much we can still do as a Parliament. This is a time of real opportunity to bring local democracy to life for the people of Scotland, the people that we all serve. We will continue our work with local government, communities themselves, and this Parliament to deliver a local democracy bill which has the potential to be the most significant change in democracy in Scotland since devolution. Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I now call Graham Simpson to speak and to and move amendment 2804.1, please. Five minutes.
Thank you very much. I have to confess to being slightly underwhelmed by the Greens' motion today. It refers to a report that was published more than 2 years ago, a report that, while it had some merit, has been largely ignored. In principle, of course, we on this side of the chamber are firmly on the side of strengthening local democracy. But unlike the Greens and Andy Whiteman, we back that up with votes in this Parliament. The Greens are guilty of horrendous hypocrisy here. When they had the chance to show they're on the side of local accountability by rejecting the SNP's centralising council tax plans, they and Labour blew it. Warm words won't cut it.
Mr. Whiteman.
Was Mr Simpson accept that the only vote we've had in Parliament on the council tax was to the multipliers? It didn't in itself make any difference to centralisation or redistribution, and that we oppose that, as I understand Mr Simpson does as well.
Mr Simpson.
Mr Whiteman knows full well that the effect of that vote was to reduce local accountability, but he voted the other way. I prefer to judge parties by their actions, and the Greens have been found wanting. That two-year-old report contained some principles we would agree with, that decisions should be taken as close to communities as possible, that democratic governance should be clear and understandable to communities with clear lines of accountability, that communities must be able to participate in decision-making, that power should be from the bottom and not the top. There are some good ideas in there, but others we would not go along with. So we don't endorse it all, which is why we're not voting for the Green motion. There's a democratic deficit emerging in Scotland where power is sucked to the centre. We've seen it with Police Scotland, health and social care integration, the fire service, and now council tax. I've said before, and I'll say it again, we are on a slippery slope. Now, when I asked Kevin Stewart if he confirmed newspaper reports that Scotland's town halls, in quotes, face being stripped of more powers in an attack on local accountability, all he could say was, Scotland doesn't have town halls. That presiding officer is not good enough. Kevin Stewart, A, didn't twig that town halls is newspaper language for councils, and B, as Andy Whiteman has said, was wrong in any case. What we need is a straight answer from the Scottish Government, and maybe Mr Stewart can provide it. Are you planning to force councils to share services and strip them of further powers over, for example, roads? Maybe that's what's in his local democracy bill. I suspect the answer is a simple yes, but ministers don't wish to own up ahead of the council elections next year. Central government is not always the best place to deliver economic growth. Local people usually know best and, given the tools, can deliver what's best for their communities. Our amendment recognises this, and the principle behind it is one that I believe the authors of the Local Democracy Report would agree with, that empowering cities and city regions is essential if we're to improve the levels of economic growth in Scotland. I'm glad Kevin Stewart agrees with that. Presumably he'll be backing our amendment. This isn't about taking powers from councils, quite the reverse, in fact. I was at a presentation by the Stirling City Region team last night. It was hugely impressive. Stirling is going to be transformed by people working collaboratively for the good of their community, crucially taking the communities with them. It's a model for the way ahead, not forcing councils to do things, but giving them the tools and resources to work together. That's how to do it. It's what led the former Chancellor down the Northern Powerhouse route. Scotland's first city deal, Glasgow, covers part of the area I represent. The story is a bit mixed there. We've got some good projects, others not so good. A couple of road schemes which in Holytown and East Kilbride, which won't benefit anyone and should be scrapped. However, our message is this. Give councils the power and they can deliver. Don't centralise. Trust people. I move the amendment in my name.
But thank you very much. I know time's tight, but it is a short debate. I now call Alec Rowley to open for Labour, please. Mr Rowley, also 5 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And speaking to this very short debate today, I would welcome the fact that the Greens have kicked off this debate. I think the Commission on Local Democracy hoped that there would be a debate across communities in Scotland on the future of local government, and I don't think that quite happened. It is interesting that the Minister for Local Government announces that he's going to bring forward this Local Democracy Bill. I certainly look forward to that happening, because I think we do need to have a debate right across Scotland about what type of local government that we want to see moving forward. The Tories simply replace, it's not really an amendment, they replace the the Green motion today, so we won't be supporting the amendment. What I would say is clearly there is a place for regional organisation and regional government in Scotland, and local authorities are actually leading that by the Glasgow City Deal, Aberdeen. Last night in this Parliament, there was a celebration of the achievement of the Stirling City Deal. So there is no doubt that we need to see some form of regional organisation around the economy, around skills, around training and cooperation. We're supportive of that, and we'll continue to work with local authorities, but that needs to be led from local authorities and not just simply the rhetoric of this place.
Mr. Simpson.
So is there any part of our amendment that you disagree with?
There's two problems. First problem with the Tory amendment is you simply replace the motion from the Greens, and we're not going to have that, because it's important to recognise that the report that was brought forward from the Commission is a good starting point, and we need to move forward with it, not rule it out. The second is you play politics, because the reality is, in terms of funding local government, your objection to what the SNP are doing with the council tax, your objection to that is that they tinker too much. What we need to do is get rid of the council tax. If it was unfair in 2007 when Nicola Sturgeon said she would replace the council tax, then, and she said at that time, and I quote, "no tinkering with the bans will make it fair," then it's still as unfair today. And the Tories' objection to that is that they're tinkering too much. What we need to do is get rid of the SNP council tax and replace it with a tax that is progressive, that will put local government finance on a financial footing moving forward. In terms of community empowerment, the question that springs to mind for me is, what is empowerment? And if you live in a community and you are homeless, then to empower you would be to give you a house. If you're living in cold, damp conditions and overcrowded, the empowerment would be to empower you by tackling fuel poverty, by giving you a house. So we can play around with the word empowerment. For me, one of the key areas of empowerment that we should have made more of over these last few years is community planning. Community planning, the concept was, I think, quite right. It failed to properly engage with communities. So whilst you may bring forward a bill that says we'll take 1% of the local authority budget and put that down to community level and ask communities how they would spend that 1%, what I would say is that community planning should result in local community plans in every community, so that the community start to set what are the priorities in their areas. So budgets is one thing, but actually setting out how the bigger budget, the 99% of the budget, is spent. How do we empower parents? How do we empower teachers? You know, you could argue that you will not take the education budget much further than the school and the classroom. But how do we actually empower the parents in those classrooms and in those schools? So in terms of this local democracy bill, it will be interesting to have that debate moving forward. But I do believe we missed a chance with community planning. I welcome the fact that we're having this debate today, not just in terms of this Parliament. That debate needs to take place in the 32 council chambers across Scotland, and it then needs to take place in the community councils and the community forums. Let's have a big debate on the future of local empowerment, local government in Scotland. It's long overdue.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rowley. I now call John Finney. Moving to open date, John Finney, to be followed by Bob Doris. No more than 4 minutes for speeches, I'm afraid. Mr. Finney.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. Let's not forget that it is local people that have fired the debate about Scotland's constitutional future, and their power must not default back to the centre. That was in the introduction of this excellent report by Councillor David O'Neill. So I think any discussions welcome, and certainly we welcome the Minister's announcement. We're very happy to engage on that. Of course, the devil will be in the detail. What we saw in this report was a number of principles outlined, one of them related to sovereignty, which I'm sure, and I dear hope, everyone can sign up to, that the people are sovereign. That's a foundation stone of Scotland's outlook. Our democratic process is about people, not about who does things to people. Another principle that was covered in the report was that of subsidiarity, and people will understand that decisions should be taken as close to communities as possible. And that's, as the report also goes on to talk about, only communities can decide on change. So just as Alec Rowley said there, that is the level of debate we need to have all the way up and down the system, but decisions coming from the bottom up, not from the top down. And the difficulty we do have is that the present models, my own former councillor was a councillor in Highland Council, that's the size of Belgium, as I understand, the largest elected body out with the Scottish Parliament. So if I tell you that, for instance, the planning committee there, a councillor will leave Wick and travel to Ardnamurchan to adjudicate on a planning decision, that is the equivalent, that's 230 miles. That's equivalent of someone in Portree deciding planning matters in Edinburgh, or put another way, someone in Doncaster in South Yorkshire deciding in Edinburgh. So when the minister said, as close as makes sense, then I'll absolutely agree with him on the issue of independence, but I hope that he'll reflect that that clearly doesn't make sense to have that level of travelling involved. And when the report goes on to talk about scale, and that's this, I've no doubt they had Highland in mind when they talked about this, they went on to say it creates an enormous gap between the local level of representative democracy and communities. So the folk in Ardnamurchan have no more in common with Caithness than the folk in South Yorkshire do with Leith. Why should they? That's not a negative comment. We need to embrace difference. But arbitrary lines, just as the minister talked about, being drawn on the map, and we've seen the recent debacle with some of the council wards, is not the way that we go about things. I think there's been some interesting issues around, and look forward to the Islands Bill being brought forward, some interesting ideas about democracy there. It's unfortunate that there isn't much time, because I would have told you about the variation instead of one-size-fits-all paragraph out of the report, which I think is very relevant. But what we do have is people who fondly remember town councils, who fondly remember district councils. There was a very close link, there was a clear identity. And the recommendation that talked about creating local tax and spending choices, this is about choices, but the people who need to make these choices are local communities. Mention's been made of the integration of health and social care. I can see that as being a positive aspect. As with the Christie Commission, there can be economies of scale that means that you can have local decision-making but shared services, and I think that's a way forward. Councillor O'Neill, in his report, says he wishes the legacy of this commission to be an alliance of voices that are ambitious together. Now, I don't think our motion is particularly ambitious. It's intended as a modest start to have the parties who, after all, as my colleague Andy Whiteman said, were involved in the process to acknowledge the work of their representatives in the process. Mentions also made in the report of the start of a new conversation. So what would have been far more ambitious would, if we had put in, and this isn't a criticism of ourselves, this was meant to be an inclusive approach. I see you saying, obviously, yeah, thanks. If we had included the final part of Councillor O'Neill's sentence was, and together make change inevitable, because we do need to invigorate our local democracy, and this is perhaps a start. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Bob Dorris, to be followed by Alec Cole-Hamilton. Mr. Dorris, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to debate themes around local government and local democracy here this afternoon. I do, however, believe that the Greens may be slightly confused over the wording of their motion in relation to local democracy. Indeed, we heard from Mr. Whiteman in relation to endorsing it doesn't mean supporting it, but it might mean supporting certain bits of it. So I'm not quite sure what we're asked to sign up today in relation to the Green motion. I do think that's unfortunate. 4 minutes, I'm sorry, gentlemen. I do think that's quite unfortunate. But I think if you look at your own comments, you'll see that's quite clear as you go back to the official report. I do, however, pay tribute to the Commission in Strengthening Local Democracy and the job that they did. But even the party that is supporting this today is not sure which bits they agree with and which bits they don't agree with. We have just concluded a debate on local educational priorities, where the Greens effectively called for ring-fenced funds for additional support needs in local authorities. Yet they begrudgingly supported £100 million for the attainment challenge each year by stating that they would not stand in the way of additional cash. I would also, that's their prerogative, of course, and I welcome the fact that they didn't stand in the way of it. I would also note that since 2007, the Scottish Government has dramatically reduced ring fencing in local authorities, as well as allowing local authorities to retain efficiency savings previously top sliced by the Labour and Lib Dem executive back in the day. Recently announced, of course, is the loosening of council tax constraints by the Scottish Government, a controversial measure to freeze the council tax at the time, but welcomed by and large across the country. Yet the Scottish Government, as was confirmed in the last debate, of course, has also stepped in to effectively ring-fence £80 million to secure teacher numbers after teacher numbers fell by 4,000 despite promises made by local authorities that weren't delivered. I'm actually sorry I got a kind of that kind of response from the Green Benches. I'm not trying to actually provoke. The point I'm trying to make is it's a bit oversimplistic. When we talk about local democracy, we have to be quite clear about what we mean, and it's multifaceted, and I don't think that's particularly reflected in the motion before us today. I think it's important to also put front and centre that the Scottish Government will introduce a bill that will decentralise local authority functions, budgets and democratic oversight to local communities. And of course, that is where the debate will move on to. And I know the Greens will have some positive words to say in relation to that. This morning at the Local Government Committee, we looked at the Community Empowerment Act and the statute instruments underpinning that. And we did note that powers do already exist to extend much more local democracy, but a culture change is needed and absolute statutory rights are coming into place in relation to asset transfers, for example. I also welcome comments around participatory budgeting. I would note that my Glasgow City Council SNP colleagues, led so ably by Susan Aiken, is talking about liberating £1 million for each and every council ward in Glasgow for local communities to decide and direct how that cash is spent. Now, that's local democracy just as much as it is councillors directing that cash or governments directing that cash, and I would commend that. In the time that I do have left, Presiding Officer, in terms of themes of local democracy, it is becoming much more difficult and complex to map that out. Because with health and social care integration, with the Educational Attainment Fund, with the scrutiny or lack of it of city deals, where have the people on the ground and local communities been involved in relation to what that money is going towards? With the review of community planning partnerships, with planning reforms and the loss of planning game, with charrettes perhaps being used in communities as a badge of honour to say we have consulted with the communities, but perhaps blocking co-production itself in relation to community developments, in relation to housing in my constituency. I don't actually think the motion before us today quite reflects all of that. So the provocation at the start is a way of explaining, I think we need more than that. What we need is a bill from the Scottish Government to look at promoting and enhancing local democracy. And that's what we're going to get, and that's what I will support.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ross. Heaven forfend your provocative. I call Alec Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Alexander Stewart, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by congratulating the Green Party on an excellent motion, which, unlike Bob Doris, the Liberal Democrats have no problem understanding the meaning of, and as such, we will have no problem supporting later tonight. Not in the first 13 seconds. On the first... Please sit down, Mr. Doris.
On Monday, James Ferguson,
a retired resident from Christofen, who subsists entirely on the state pension, came to see me. He was incandescent that his council tax, set to be increased so that the Scottish Government can defund Edinburgh and then redistribute money into other parts of the country. So angry was he that he was ready to take to the streets and stop paying council tax altogether. That a pensioner should be incited to civil disobedience is an indictment of that policy and the final straw in the tolerance of many people who perceive that this government is once again meddling in local government. As we have heard, the Commission for Strengthening Local Democracy points to a trend of centralisation that has spanned 50 years in this country. In that time, we've seen the number of local councils evaporate from 203 to just 32. And then the 2011 Commission on the Future Delivery of Public Services hinted that this could be cut still further. I hope in her remarks the Cabinet Secretary, when closing, will confirm that the Local Democracy Bill will not seek to reduce our councils still further. Presiding Officer, in over half a century of centralisation, many social indicators would suggest that the flow of power to the centre has not yielded positive results. The gap between rich and poor has widened, whilst educational attainment has fallen. And at no point in that time has the pace of centralisation been as great as it has been under this SNP administration. Under the sheep's clothing of the 2007 Concordat, the Scottish Government claimed to unencumber our communities from the strictures of ring fencing. He did so whilst robbing it of the only revenue levers at their disposal. For nearly a decade, with the council tax immobilised by SNP policy, we have not had an effective system of local taxation in this country. And despite winning two successive elections, I don't have time, I'm afraid, and with two successive elections on a commitment to scrap it, this government has singularly failed to do so. Presiding Officer, the SNP exalt those Scandinavian countries who hint at the prosperity we might enjoy as an independent nation, but they do not seek to emulate them. Norway alone, with a population nearly identical to ours, has 428 municipalities. The success of countries like this is down to that absolute preeminence of the principle of subsidiarity, that fundamental liberal belief that power works better when it is closer to the people. Yet Scotland already has the lowest number of councils in Europe. Certainly, there are savings to be made in economies of scale through things like the shared service agenda, but these should not come at the expense of a society where power is devolved to the lowest level possible. The policy trajectory of this government is one of centralisation, big government and control. Evident in the police service now applying Strathclyde solutions to Edinburgh's problems, while frontline morale falls through the floor. Evident in the anxiety of healthcare professionals for the rumours that they hear of merger across our health boards. And evident in the creeping erosion of the power of local government. Last week, the First Minister admonished me for suggesting that the Lib Dems were trying to intervene in local planning. We are seeking to empower authorities so that they can compel developers on planning gain. Presiding Officer, it is incumbent on us as legislators and as representatives to walk lightly through the lives of the people we serve, that this Parliament must stay the hand of our ministers so that we are an enabling force, not a controlling force in our communities. And we must be ever conscious, without reversal of this centralisation, then those who would be seeking further empowerment will soon find that the most frustrating words, the 10 most frustrating words in our language are, I'm from the Scottish Government and I'm here to help.
Thank you very much. Call Alexander Stewart, followed by Colin Smith. Mr. Stewart, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As someone who has served in local government for 17 years in Perth and Kinross, I am very much aware of the part that local democracy plays. Deputy Presiding Officer, local councillors really are at the coalface, and it's through that that we need to ensure that constituents come to local councillors and they believe that there's a much better cooperation between them than sometimes other tiers of government that we find. And so decisions are better taken by people closer to and familiar with the communities which they reflect and look after. In regard to these benches here today, at least we can support the principle which is mentioned in the 2014 report reflected in the Greens motion. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is 2 years old. I know from the sole purpose of most of the debates at the moment seem to be to fill the SNP's legislation vacuum that we seem to have. And so much has changed with regard to local democracy since this report was published. In recent years, the decision of travel has gone one way, and that's into the centre. We have seen more and more things being put into Holyrood than dealing with us at council level on all spheres. Our local police force is one. Councillors no longer sit on joint police boards, and I, for one, feel that is a loss to democratic processes within our communities. It's vitally important that the local democracy that we have is kept. And we find now that councils themselves are in straitjackets across Scotland. Planning is a particular local issue that can at times become extremely controversial. But again, the Scottish Government has seen fit to ignore and undermine decisions that are taken at local level. Last year, they overruled over half of the local planning decisions that were taken. That is not accountability, Deputy Presiding Officer. That is control from the centre. At the same time, and perhaps unsurprisingly, given their approach to local government, the Scottish Government have continually cut funding to local government. And now, after 9 years of a council tax freeze, we will now see a council tax rise for individuals within this community. And what is that tax rise going to show? It's going to show that the SNP have a new proposal, and that's to cut away the clear link between local democracy and local councils and individuals, and we're ending up, they're going to be paying for a national priority, something that we should not be doing at all at local level. Presiding Officer, the Scottish National Party talk about bringing powers closer to the people. That is a myth. They are interested in more powers in the place, hoarding powers and demanding more powers, constraining powers from local government and making sure that they have as much as they can here. The SNP, often aided and abetted by the Scottish Labour Party and the Greens, are the real threat to local democracy in Scotland. In sharp contrast, however, the UK government have been working continually with the Scottish local authorities to forge new deals, which they have seen and are coming to fruition across Scotland. These deals will allow greater flexibility for local authorities by working in partnership and continually doing all they can to ensure that local communities do well. Developing more powers in regions will allow them to design policies that better suit their own areas, supporting economic growth, facilitating more job creation, and investing in local infrastructure. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would urge the Scottish Government to acknowledge the fact that many decisions are best taken closer to the communities that affect them, and I therefore am happy to support the amendment in Graham Simpson's name.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. Call Colin Smith, we followed by Graham Day. Colin Smith is the penultimate speaker in the open debate. Mr Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I declare an interest as a local councillor? Can I congratulate also that the Scottish Greens in choosing the issue of local democracy for today's debate? I have to confess...
Just wondering that.
Thank you very much. I have to confess to being a bit of an admirer of Andy Whiteman's contributions to this subject over the years, which very much predate his election to this Parliament, and his observations today do not disappoint. I may not always agree with some of his proposed remedies for the local democratic deficit we face, namely his suggestion of 180 municipalities and six or so strategic regions, but I do agree with him 100% in his short and to the point, easily understood motion today. No one with any credibility can dispute the fact that Scotland has the most centralised relationship between local and central government within the European Union after a 50-year journey of centralisation. And the debate isn't about whether that leaves us out of step internationally. That's taken as read. The debate is between those of us who recognise that if we're serious about tackling inequalities or disenchantment with politics, that position has to change, and those on the other side of the debate who think centralisation is acceptable. Sadly, more often than not, this government fits into the latter category, and the journey of centralisation has accelerated in Scotland in the past decade. The Scottish Government's instinct when establishing Police Scotland was to select a model that sucked powers and jobs from peripheral areas into the central belt and ended any meaningful local accountability. When it comes to funding local councils, there's no meaningful negotiations, just imposition. And if local government dares to call for a fair settlement, the threat of sanctions is waved in their face. Despite the fact that for 2016-17, the Scottish Government grant from the UK Government did increase, albeit by a far too low 0.7%, the Scottish Government imposed a 4.5% cut in the revenue grant to local councils. On the day income tax powers worth £12 billion will be passed to this Parliament, I can reflect on the fact that in my decade as a local councillor, I've never once had the power to set the council tax in my area. And it would never cross the mind of this government or the Tories to use those new tax powers to protect funding to councils, showing contempt not just for local government, but for the very services our local communities rely on. Services recent research by Spice and Glasgow and Heriot Watt universities showed are used most by those on low incomes. Never before have we seen such disregard for local government and such a systematic breakdown in the relationship between local and central government than the one we are witnessing today. Local government is seen not as a partner of the Scottish Government, as the Minister claims, but as the enemy. For the past 5 years, Scottish politics has been dominated by the debate on which power should come to the Scottish Parliament from the UK Parliament. Yet when anyone suggests a meaningful debate on whether some of those powers of this Parliament would better sit in local government, look at the reaction of SNP MSPs. Joe McAlpin, in their Daily Record column, famously said those wanting to devolve powers to local councils did so because they wanted to, quote, bring down our Parliament. Apparently, anyone who thinks a local council may be better placed to deliver a back-to-work programme is an enemy of the state, according to Ms McAlpin. I'm sorry, but it's time for the more grown-up politicians to have a serious debate about which powers should now be devolved from this Parliament to local communities, and that, Minister, includes local government. It's very much the real unfinished business of the Smith Commission. Indeed, as Lord Smith said in his introduction to the Commission's report, there is a strong desire to see the principle of devolution extended further. So maybe it's time for a Smith Commission too to look at that work. Because for all this government's warm words about devolving powers to communities, participatory budgeting, some of the positive aspects of the Community Empowerment Act, it needs to get over its distrust and paranoia towards democratically elected councils. It needs to take seriously the balanced, well-argued and clearly evidenced recommendations set out by the Commission on strengthening local democracy. Recommendations that anyone who genuinely believes in local democracy would have no problem whatsoever supporting.
Thank you very much. On the button. I now call Graeme Day, who's the last speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is a direction of travel being established around this important issue. A bill, as we've heard, to decentralise local council authority functions and budgets, and manifesto commitments from the government party for a reform for community planning partnerships to bring forward, amongst other things, the use of citizens' panels and town hall meetings, the introduction of community choice budgeting, and looking at properly functioning community councils delivering some services, all surely welcome. But it does strike me that there are two things which should be at the core of any and all deliberations around the future nature of local democracy and taking forward such measures. The first of these is a preparedness to listen. The second is fully exploring the merits and practicalities of any suggestions which come forward. Let me deal with those in order. There are reasons why people are feeling disconnected with existing local democratic structures and how these deliver. We need to develop a proper understanding of that disconnect, not assume we know the reasons and can identify the solutions. And that will only come about through genuinely seeking and taking on board the views of the public. I participated in a public event in Kirriemuir, my constituency, a couple of months ago, looking at the future of local governance. It was well attended and ultimately, from my perspective, quite thought-provoking. But by the time I, as the last speaker, rose to make my contribution, the audience had been talked at for the best part of 2 hours. And worse still, one of the contributors had actually taken the folk there to task for not being sufficiently enthusiastic in their response to the views that they were advancing. We need to be prepared to listen, but also then explore, in partnership, whether what might look like a better approach would work effectively in practice. Which brings me to practicalities. It's easy to promote introducing lots of smaller councils without exploring how that would work in practice and whether other mechanisms might deliver greater benefits. And easy to identify apparently successful instances of local governance structures from other countries and call for these to be implemented here without examining, amongst other things, the circumstances in which these have worked and therefore whether we could in reality implement them or versions of them here. Both might appeal and indeed have their merits, but change, however well intentioned at first glance, is rarely without difficulty if not properly thought through. Presiding Officer, we need to have genuine conversations and then explore in partnership very carefully how we improve local democracy in order that we deliver real improvement of the kind that meets realistic aspirations and works. And the work around the community planning partnerships, certainly the proposals around those, might offer that chance. And that's not to risk, as the Commission identifies, trading away fundamental change for more modest ideas, but to explore the pros and cons and practicalities of change, and most importantly of all, to set about this whole process in a way which rebuilds eroded capacity and confidence within communities that they can participate effectively in decision-making at a local level, as the report calls for. That's the key here, not the structures of whether we need many more small councils. What we need to show is that people can have their views listened to and then delivered. We need to provide mechanisms for them to have a proper say in how services are delivered for their communities. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. This pen's becoming very scary. Everybody's keeping to their time. Excellent. I call on Polly McNeill to close for Labour. 4 minutes, Ms. McNeill.
Thank you. Many people are understandably losing interest in a democracy over which they feel little influence, where decisions are taken far away from where they live. Page 6 of the report we're debating this evening, for me, it's about the heart of the very challenge. I've always believed that the financial crash of 2008 would trigger the start of something very big in public reaction. I suspected then that ordinary people would find a way to respond to the earthquake that robbed them of their pension, their wage rises, their belief in the modern democratic capitalist system. A bit strong, you might say, for a debate about local democracy, but for me personally, this is exactly the point. The revelation that the banks and the financial sector were selling people credit that they obviously could not afford. As the political economist Joseph Stiglitz put it, there was a party going on and only a few people at the top were invited, but the rest of us were asked to pay the bill. Worse than that, they had conspired to manipulate the economy with accompanying criminal actions in some cases, believing they would not be found out. I believe that that event has rocked our democratic system to its very core. Because if you add to that, if you were held to account for this in the democratic system that we've grown up in, people's elected representatives did little to ensure redress for the fact that it will take generations to recover from the fallout of this world's recession. We've heard in previous debates the average pay for executives has risen, in fact, £4 million between 2002 and 2012. And over the same period, real pay did not increase at all for the average worker. So people feel remote from power, not just political power, but institutional power. And there is a deep distrust of the political model politicians who preach business as usual. Is it any wonder that voting trends have become unpredictable? And as we've also previously debated, there are dangers lurking as people's insecurities are exploited by right-wing parties across Europe and here on our doorstep. So I believe a radical overhaul of power and accountability is needed throughout the UK at every level and here in Scotland. This debate is about how we can devolve power down to and from all levels of government, essential, I believe, to restore faith in our democracy. In many cases where people feel that they are closer to how decisions are being made and that they feel a part of it, will be to be a start in how people might feel that their faith in the democratic system has been restored. Local government must be trusted to take more power to govern for the communities that they represent. But in turn, communities must also have more of a say in planning and long-term decisions. Not easy to get that right, but I agree with Andy Whiteman that there should be some strategy provision to ensure that those rights are embedded in law for local communities. Brexit may yet prove to be an opportunity to devolve more power across the United Kingdom and construct new local democratic ways of getting people involved. But that does mean a halt to the centralising agenda that this government seems bound for. I commend the government for the creation of the Community Empowerment Act of the last Parliament, an excellent piece of legislation. But I don't think it has been driven with any passion so far, and I'd like to see that happen in this Parliament. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, as SEVO say, open government is all about a new relationship between citizens and the state, and it's time to make a start in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. I call Adam Tompkins to close for the Conservatives. 4 minutes, please. Mr Tompkins.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. The most alarming suggestion in this debate came a few moments ago, where it was suggested that there should be some kind of Smith Commission too, to consider questions of local government in Scotland. And there was a cross-party shudder that was shared, I think, by Patrick Harvey and myself at that appalling suggestion. The greatest single challenge facing Scotland today.
Mr Harvey.
I'm sure your fellow DPO would share that horror, but is there perhaps,
I'm not allowed
if not
to
a
comment.
Call for a Smith Commission too, is there perhaps a call for something akin to a fiscal framework, not between UK and Scottish, but between Scottish and local government?
Mr Tompkins.
I'll come to that in a few moments, if I may. The greatest single challenge facing Scotland today is how we grow our economy, and in particular how we grow our economy relative to the rest of the United Kingdom. This is what government policy should be resolutely focused on. But I suggest it's also what we should have at the forefront of our minds when we think in Scotland about local government. Now, there's much in the report of the Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy with which we agree. Scotland is far too centralised, and this is a problem that has grown much worse under the SNP. As a nation, we have not had a mature, reflective rethink of the role or scope or shape of local government in Scotland since before the dawn of devolution in 1999. The Commission's report is right about all of these things. But we cannot endorse a report that we don't altogether agree with. Andy Whiteman and Alec Cole-Hamilton may be able to endorse something that they disagree with, but I agree with Bob Doris, there's a first, that that's an intellectual contortion too far. Where the report falls down in it is its failure to say anything. I can't, I'm afraid, Mr. Whiteman, because I don't have time. Is its failure to say anything at all about the vital role that local government can and must have in boosting the local economy. Last night in this very parliament, as Graham Simpson said, there was a quite brilliant presentation of the Stirling and Clackmannanshire city deal bid. And at its core, like all the UK's various city, region and other growth deals, is a programme of innovative and potentially transformative economic regeneration and development. And the city that I represent, Glasgow, led the way in Scotland. When its city deal was signed in 2014, it was the richest anywhere in the United Kingdom, worth more than £1.1 billion to the local economy. And it's fabulous that thanks to the Chancellor's autumn statement last week, there is now to be a city deal for every city in Scotland. The importance of this was recognised in a report published in June of this year, a report that I, for one, certainly would have endorsed, but one which we've never debated in this Parliament, a sign, I fear, of how little the SNP government is interested in it. The report, Empowering Scotland's Cities, understands that cities and their regions are the real economic drivers of Scotland, but that without what the report calls radical change to current working practices between central and local government, our cities will be comprehensively outperformed by their English counterparts. The devolution of power to England cities has galvanised them. They have a confidence and a sense of ambition that is not only evident within them, but which is projected to the wider world too. With devolved powers, cities can better integrate transport networks, streamline planning decisions, make localised decisions on skills and support for business, and promote an attractive and competitive image and identity. That's the future of local government. That's what we need here in Scotland too. And that's the vision, unlike the Greens' motion, ambitious and aspirational as it avowedly is of local government, that we endorse on these benches. I support the amendment in Graham Simpson's name.
Thank you very much. I call Nigel Constance to close for the Governor, Cabinet Secretary. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr. Whiteman started his contribution today by saying that he and the Green Party didn't support every detail of the COSLA Commission, and I suppose that's the starting point for this government as well. And I have to confess, you know, not unreasonably, in taking quite a literal interpretation of the meaning of the word endorse. Nonetheless, I think this debate is a good opportunity for us to begin to explore where we do have common ground. And I do agree with Alec Rowley when he said that the COSLA Commission was a good starting point. And I do also, Presiding Officer, want to pay tribute to Councillor David O'Neill for his tenure in local government and his time of service in COSLA, and wish him well for when he retires next May. But there is a strong agreement that this government, and I believe is shared, the wide-held view that local democracy in Scotland can be improved. It can be improved to empower communities, engage individuals, all with a view to delivering better outcomes. And if I can quote Councillor O'Neill by saying that, and this is where I do agree with him, we understand how difficult it is to throw off the shackles of the current way of looking at democracy. However, the reality is that if we are serious about making Scotland fairer, wealthier and healthier, then we need to start putting local communities in control of what matters to them. And of course, we do have to balance equity with localism. We have to ensure that there is an equitable provision and of public services at an appropriate standard, and we have to take that forward in tandem with the need for greater local decision making and local autonomy and flexibility. And I would stress to Mr. Simpson and others that this is a tripartite interest in making these improvements. That work has to span local government, Scottish Government, and most importantly, it has to include communities. And that's why in the working group that will be established, it will include the Scottish Government, it will include COSLA, it will include, on an equal basis, community organisations. And that working group will build on the platform of the work that's went before it, but that will lead in to the introduction of the Local Democracy Bill. No thanks. I'm usually generous with my time, but not today. But if I can reassure Mr. Simpson that there is no tablet of stone, he shouldn't, of course, believe everything he reads in the Sunday papers, but that we are going forward with this bill in the spirit of co-production. And in terms of the claims about centralisation, have to point out that the number of councillors scrutinising Police Scotland since the reforms has actually doubled. Yeah. Police Scotland also have local plans at a multi-member ward level. And we, of course, have 31 integrated joint boards where elected members are involved in the scrutiny and the implementation of health and social care reforms as well. And it was this government that brought forward, with much passion and much relish, the Community Empowerment Act. And in terms of the city deals, as a government, we will invest over the next 10 to 20 years £760 million to support that vision of economic growth becoming a reality. I do have to confess, however, we don't have much enthusiasm for mayors, and I haven't detected any strong desire across Scotland for directly elected mayors with that executive power. That, to me, would seem to be an example of centralisation. I do want to point out, Presiding Officer, that the Social Attitudes Survey of August 2016 tells us that 96% of Scots think that local people should be involved in making decisions about the design and delivery of their public services and how resources are spent. And this is where I do disagree with Mr. Whiteman, because I believe community empowerment and community involvement has to be at the very heart of local governance, and it has to be at the very heart of the debate that we will take forward about the changes that need to be made in local democracy. And we have to move to services and provision being by communities and not necessarily always on behalf of communities. And that will very much inform our thinking as we take public sector reform to its next stage. All the discussion, thinking and reports, whether it's the COSLA Commission, the work done by the Local Government and Regeneration Committee in the previous Parliament, the Jimmy Reid Foundation, the work done by Solace, all of that has laid strong foundations. So the challenge now for us all is we need to get on with the work, translating words into deeds and building that new democratic framework for Scotland. And we have to continue to listen and learn from experts. We can't cherry pick from other countries. We have to really look and learn and apply that to a Scottish context. We have to recognise that as we work together in the next chapter of our democratic story, that no single size, no one size fits all in terms of the agenda that we pursue. And I'm very conscious of the cost to the public purse of the last round of local government reorganisation. And I'm also conscious of the need to build capacity in communities. And that's why we've invested heavily in the Empowering Community and People and Communities Fund at £20 million.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. I call on Alison Johnson to close for the Green Party till 5:30, please, Ms Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank all of those who've contributed to this lively debate this afternoon. I welcome the comments by the Minister on the introduction of a local democracy bill, and I do hope this signals a move away from further centralisation. To Gordon Simpson of the Scottish Conservatives and to Bob Doris, I would point out that your representatives on the Commission did not dissent from the recommendations of the report. Alex Rowley is right to highlight, I will not give way at this point, Mr. Doris. Alex Rowley is right to highlight that empowerment is experienced in different ways by different people according to their circumstances. And Alex Cole-Hamilton is right to point out the opposition to the government's top slicing of council tax. It's a priority that is shared, but local authorities must be empowered to raise revenue. And as for Alexander Stewart's painting of Andy Whiteman as the greatest threat to local democracy, well, what can I say? Now, the Scottish Greens manifesto said that Scotland can be a bolder democracy, and I'm sure we would all agree. In his book, Missing Scotland, Willie Sullivan reminds us that 10% and more of potential voters in Scotland aren't registered and aren't voting in elections. Now, by international comparisons, that's not too bad, but Willie rightly says, gratitude at not being the worst shouldn't translate into an acceptance of not being as good as we could be. In the heat of an election campaign, we focus entirely on those who intend to vote, yet afterwards, when we learn of turnouts as low as 20% in some wards in local authority elections, we carry on as before. Yes, areas in Scotland where 80% of people have declined to exercise their right to vote. in Iceland in 2006, turnout dropped below 80% for the first time. There was an academic inquiry, soul-searching, as to why this had happened. The Electoral Reform Society commissioned to do a poll by Act As If We Own The Place, a poll of local people, and only 1% said that local politics interests them more than watching the telly. 46% said they'd prefer to stay in bed than vote, and almost a quarter said they'd prefer to finish the ironing. Now, a strong democracy isn't just about voting, so I was heartened to learn that in the same poll, 45% of people said they'd give up half a day each month at least to improve their local community. Now, this doesn't surprise me. As a grassroots activist and then councillor in Edinburgh, I met hundreds of people actively campaigning to keep their schools and nurseries opened, fighting to save the only local green play space, attempting to overcome the might of professional power and vested interests that put global chain stores before shops where local folk can buy their tea. People are passionate about what happens in their streets and communities, but in all those cases I've mentioned, the community view was rejected. No matter how many meetings people had attended, no matter how many had completed what they saw as infuriating text-box consultations, they'd spent months meeting in each other's home, reading complex council papers, poring over planning proposals, making homemade banners, writing to the local press, up against, at times, the might of paid lawyers, lobbyists, developers, professionals with expertise and budgets to match. And after such an experience, many people despair. They feel disempowered, quite frankly, scunnered. Indeed, the Old Town Community Council, which represents this part of the city, disbanded entirely following an unequal and demoralising planning battle. Too often, politics and democracy is seen as something which is done to people rather than with them. And if we believe, and the Scottish Greens and I do, that decisions that impact people's lives should be taken where they impact most on people, then the local decision-making bodies must be fully empowered. Fiscal empowerment is key to empowering local government to deliver the outcomes we want. This lack of empowerment is having a negative effect on engagement. Elections at community council level are a rarity, and no wonder. While local participation in budget setting is slowly increasing, it's fair to say that the amounts are far from transformative. Communities are told what spend they can and can't affect with their vote. And while many bring great experience as statutory consultees in areas like planning and licensing, the voluntary time and effort expended by community councils across Scotland too often comes to naught. We can do so much better. The difference in voter turnout in the most and least affluent parts of this country are stark, yet engaging our disengaged communities is key to addressing inequality, as empowerment is key to increasing well-being. Not surprisingly, those who enjoy better health are far more likely to vote in an election. Imagine if those active people I've spoken about were able to put their skills to more positive use. Instead of taking on the council, they were working with them as equal partners. Scotland can revive local democracy by devolving more powers to local councils and requiring them to include local communities in decision making. Change is required. Our local authorities really aren't that local. John Finney referred to a 3.5-hour trip to be involved in a planning decision. We need to build on the cross-party work which went into COSLA's Commission for Strengthening Local Democracy. The final report sets the scene, explained the context. Scotland's local government is not local. There's a growing default position that efficient delivery increasingly means centralisation. By all means, be challenged by the recommendations in the report, but welcome them. Yes, proudly endorse them and vote for the Green motion this evening. Thank you.
That concludes our debate. Sorry, a point of order from Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to raise a point of order regarding a vote that took place at the beginning of this month on the council tax substitution of proportion order. All of the information provided by the Scottish Government and Spice made it clear that that only changed the multiplier of council tax and said nothing at all about how it would be spent or by whom. And yet, Graeme Simpson in today's debate accused the Greens of supporting centralisation by voting for that order. Presiding Officer, I understand that if Mr. Simpson is purely trying to misrepresent our position, that's a matter for him. That's a matter for him, not for you. But can we have your assurance that all of the information provided to Parliament was accurate on that matter? Surely we need to have the confidence to say that Mr. Simpson is entirely responsible for his own complete failure to understand what he was voting for.
I would thank Mr. Harvey for the advance notice of a point of order. I will take it to assess the information for myself, but that's a debating point that you're making, not a point of order. Now that concludes our debate on local democracy. The next item of business is consideration of a legislative consent motion on the Policing and Crime Bill. I would ask Michael Matheson to move motion 2806.
Moved.
Thank you very much. The question on this motion is at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2840 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick. On behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme, I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 2840.
Formally moved.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak against the motion. I'll put the question to the chamber then. The question is that motion number 2840 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2837 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a timetable on stage one for the Limitation Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against this motion to press their request to speak button now. I would call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 2837.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I put the question to the chamber. Do we agree that in motion 2837, are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 2838 on approval of an SSI.
Moved.
And that question will come at decision time, to which we now come. There are eight questions. At decision time, I wish to remind members that in relation to the debate on education, if the amendment in the name of John Swinney is agreed, the amendment in the name of Liz Smith falls. So the first question is that amendment 2809.3 in the name of John Swinney, which seeks to amend motion 2809 in the name of Ross Greer on education, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 2809.3 in the name of John Swinney is yes 62, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. The amendment in the name of Liz Smith falls. So the next question is that motion 2809 in the name of Ross Greer as amended be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 2809 in the name of Ross Greer as amended is yes 83, no 34. There were six abstentions and the motion as amended is therefore agreed. Now I wish to remind members that in relation to the debate on local democracy, if the amendment in the name of Kevin Stewart is agreed, the amendment in the name of Graham Simpson falls. So the question is that amendment 2804.2 in the name of Kevin Stewart, which seeks to amend motion 2804 in the name of Andy Whiteman on local democracy, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now.
The result of the vote on amendment number 2804.2 in the name of Kevin Stewart is yes 61, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore, well, I use my casting vote. I use my casting vote and I cast against the amendment. So the amendment is not agreed. And so the next question is Graeme Simpson's, yes. So the next question is that amendment 2804.1 in the name of Graeme Simpson, which seeks to amend motion 2804 in the name of Andy Whiteman on local democracy, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 2804.1 in the name of Graeme Simpson is yes 92, no 31. The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 2804 in the name of Andy Whiteman, as amended, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed? No, we're not agreed. We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 2804 in the name of Andy Whiteman as amended is yes 96, no 27. There were no abstentions and the motion as amended is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 2806 in the name of Michael Matheson on a legislative consent motion on the Policing and Crime Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And the final question is that motion 2838 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. And that concludes decision time. We'll move to a member's business in the name of Kezia Dugdale. If members could move on quietly. No.